y'all doing this morning? It's like church, y'all can be seated now. Hey now, hey now. Y'all doing all right? Y'all ain't gonna leave all them lights on in here, just light being gone. So has everybody been having a good time on the ship so far? It's good to see all y'all again. I don't know if I've ever done a show this early in the morning, so y'all bear with me. That's the real reason they brought extra bartenders in here tonight. So, never done one this early, so. I figured we'd get warmed up with one we may all know. I'm gonna play y'all some stuff that I grew up on. From some guys you may know well, but the songs may be a little obscure to you. Just to kind of give you a picture of, you know, the music I grew up on and what inspired me to start doing this in the very first place. I know that y'all enjoyed the show the other night, and give yourself a round of applause for kicking ass. Y'all did absolutely amazing. It was unbelievable in here, the energy the other night. So, figured since we just got done with our coffee, we'd keep it a little calm this morning and ease into it. But come Saturday, by God. All right? Now, as the rules go, if you know the song, you might as well sing it. It makes me sound a whole lot better when y'all cover me up. Take a freight train down at the station, Lord. I don't care where to go. Gonna climb a mountain, the highest mountain, Lord. Jump on, nobody gonna know. Can't you see? Oh, can't you see? Good music, man. If y'all, you know, anybody ever heard country, southern rock and roll, it's A lot of people say it's three chords and the truth, and there ain't no doubt about that, man. Can't You See was one of the first things I ever learned to play on guitar. It was super simple. And 10 years later, I only messed that one up one time, so. So anyway, that's that three chords and the truth, that's a very, very true statement. So many of my songs, that same little chord progression right there is the nuts and bolts of you know, 10, 15 of my songs, you know what I mean? But, you know, throw a little something different on them and you never know. Change your key with this cheater stick right here that some people call the capo. I call it the cheater stick. So this is one with that same one. A lot of folks ask me from time to time if I've got a favorite. I like them all. This one right here is top of the list. I'll sing it with me. Well, I was born down in Dixie on the South Street. And Daddy was a driller, a wild hog killer. Mama, she was Cherokee. I was the second one, the youngest little son of the South. He brought me up red, taught me to love him, went to fight and had a tough it out. Started, my addictions are that young lady right over there. Basketball games on TV and potato chips. So there you go. Don't ask me
about that. There you go. If you have a question, go ahead and raise your hand. I'll start off, Frank. If you weren't doing this, if you weren't a singer and touring What would be your other dream job?
Well, I had another dream a long, long time ago. From the time I was 6, 7 years old, man, I picked up a basketball and I ran with it. And I chased that dream until it got out of sight, as I like to say. So that was my dream. But, you know, I played high school basketball and was lucky enough to have a lot of success doing that. Had a good time, won a state championship, which was pretty awesome. And believe it or not, what I tell people, a lot of years ago, I actually played college basketball. I played 2 years of junior college ball at Bossier Parish Community College in Bossier City, Louisiana. And then I went out to Pembroke, North Carolina, and played a Division II school out there, University of North Carolina, Pembroke. And a little known fact, that's where my wife started chasing me around campus out there. So we've been together ever since. She was playing softball out there, and I was playing basketball, and she played hard to get, and it didn't work. So, so do not regret going out to North Carolina and playing basketball. Everything happens for a reason. So I and Ashley and now Fox and my family and what we've built, I feel like that's the reason that I started chasing basketball so long ago, so I could run into her one day. I love you.
Awesome. What's your name?
Mike.
Mike, where are you from?
Mike.
New Orleans, Louisiana.
Yeah.
New Orleans.
Go ahead.
What the story behind That Kid?
Yeah.
That song and Gulf Coast Cowboy, we'd like you to play that some more.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. Well, That Kid, since I'm already crying 10 minutes into the show, That Kid is a...
Do you have a question? What's your name?
Kayla.
Where are you from?
Eunice, Louisiana.
Oh, man, shout Eunice, Louisiana. What's your question, hon?
Frank, I think it's beautiful that you love your wife like you do your mommy and your husband.
Mm.
You look like you need a hug. You want a hug, cousin?
Well, I don't
cousin
know.
Cousin loves everybody.
Okay. Well, if I need to, I will. It's going to make me feel better.
It's going to
make you feel better.
Anybody else have a question, real quick? Over here. Oh, since I'm right here. What's your name?
Stacy.
Stacy.
Where are you from?
Missouri.
Uh-huh. Show me stuff.
Hey, I'll get y'all a lighter note. How was it playing with Hank Jr.?
Dude, absolutely wonderful. Those people who are close to me, Hank Williams Jr. is the absolute reason I picked up a guitar several years ago. He's, give him a hand. In my opinion, the greatest to ever do it. Now, my dad argues with me about that because he thinks Hank Sr.'s the greatest to ever do it. And that's a hard argument. But playing with Hank Jr. was a dream. You know, it's one of the most surreal things that I've ever experienced. I never thought that I would get the chance to do that. And to get that call not only once, to get it several times, and we're doing it with him again this year, has just been an absolute dream. And we did a 3-show run with him, I think it was last year, the year before, and we got to get on the stage and sing Family Tradition with Hank Williams Jr. And I think we've all dreamed about that moment. No matter whether you're a singer or not, they could have buried me with a smile after that night. So if something happens to me tomorrow, just know I'm a happy man, because that made my life right there. Anybody else? Get one more, Mike, we'll play something else.
What's your name?
Rick.
Hey, Rick, where are you from?
Virginia.
Virginia in the house.
Like it.
So on your new album, you got a song on there, In the Wind.
Yeah.
And I want to know if there was a story behind that.
Yeah, the In the Wind story is kind of like That Kid story, and I think I'm over it now, so we'll kind of blend those together. In the Wind, I wrote that in soundcheck one day in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. We were, me and the guys were, hey man, we got some Alabama folks in here? All right, we won't hold that against you, I promise. But yeah, I started In the Wind and wrote it in Tuscaloosa, Alabama one day, and I didn't really know what it was about, to be honest with you. But when I wrote the bridge and the final verse after that day when we left, it kind of all came back to John Moss, who is what that kid is about. John Moss is a boy who grew up right down the road from us, and his parents busted up when he was young. And my folks, took him in and raised him, and we lost him, and I'm just... He wouldn't have believed all this, I guarantee you. On that note, let's play a sad song, what do you say? I've never really played this show, this song live. I can't remember playing it live. If I did, I probably had too much to drink, was feeling like I feel right now. Played it somewhere for 16 people in a bar in, you know, North Arkansas or something. He married early. You worked two jobs, put it through school. Gave his last dollar, she got her degree. After all he sacrificed, she still hadn't learned her plea. Now there's a quarter moon in a teen sand tan. He's been drinking, she's been gone. Y'all, that's a country song. She left her heart open, got swept off of her feet. A man with all the fine things, a lot of money. And loaded up her car. She headed off to Dallas, and he headed off to the bar. Now there's a quarter moon and a teen sand tan. She's moving up and he's going down. He's been drinking, she's been gone. He had whiskey on his last breath. All them years were just too hard. His last words were burying me out in the backyard. And time also found her regretting what she'd done. She thought of him and her old life. She headed back home. She cries, oh no, she sees a headstone. Now she's been drinking. So we don't play that song a lot, but I will tell you this. That's one of the songs I'm most proud of that I've ever sat down and wrote. I feel like it's something that could have been on the radio way back when, and it translates to today. And my dad, he thinks it's the best damn thing ever happened. So if it makes him happy, it makes me happy. Some folks I want to acknowledge on the front row here. These folks halfway helped raise me too. That's my Uncle Hop, raise your hand. Miss Sherry, his better half. And Mr. Mark Ledbetter and his beautiful wife, Lisa, y'all wave your hands. Look. These two cats right here, when I was coming up, was the coolest dudes around, all right? So my dad put me on Hank Sr. when I was just a youngin'. And man, I played that I call them standing on the front seat songs. You know when you're 4 or 5 and you stand on the front seat of like an old Pontiac or something, you're riding to the fishing hole. So that was the stuff I grew up listening to. And then I ran across the road and Uncle Hop, he said, "You ever heard of Hank Jr.?" I said, "No, who's that?" He's like, "Your daddy don't know nothing about this." Jace, come help me out, or somebody. I'm batteried out, packed out. But anyway, he said he don't know nothing about this. So Uncle Hop put me on some Hank Jr., and then he put me on some Waylon Jennings, and he put me on a whole bunch of other stuff. So y'all can thank Uncle Hop for scarring me up pretty bad when it came to all that. But anyway, and Mark Ledbetter, man, he used to have a red and tan. What year model is that Ford, Mark? Huh? 1990 model short bed Ford pickup. Clean, baby, I'm talking about. Clean. He'd come by my house. I'd be out there playing Hank Jr. I'd be out there shooting basketball, kicking dirt up, you know. Barefoot champ right here, dirt court champ, baby. I'd be out there shooting ball. Mark would come by in that Ford Hank Jr. wide ass open, I'm talking about. Jam. And who else old enough to remember the old Pepsi commercial? This right here. That was Ledbetter's move, that's it. Got him. So, yeah, these two cats, man, I love them to death. And they've been to 50 shows. If they've been the one, they just keep following me around, and it makes me happy every time. One more cat I want to call out. There's a lot of people that I know in here. Jeremy Showman, where are you at? Stand up. This cat right here, y'all. You talk about true coon ass. There's one right there, boy. Look, Jeremy Chauvin has been one of my best friends since the day I walked in the Gulf of Mexico. He's that dude, he's just like Topher. I met him and the first thing I want to do is hit him right between the eyes. And then, you know, you stay out there and you start living with somebody and I realize this is one of the coolest cats I've ever met. Chauvin, you've been awesome, man. Been a great buddy, I love you. So a little known fact about Chauvin is, so I was sitting offshore one day, up in a little something we call the computer shack, hiding out, as I was doing back then. I had one album out, and I was touring up and down the road in a white van with a U-Haul trailer, thinking I was doing it big, I'm talking about you. So I was up there one night when I probably should have been working, and I had this thing with me, or one that was about $800 cheaper than this one, probably, to be honest. So Showman walks in the computer shack. He said, "What you working on, boy?" I said, "Do what?" He said, "What you working on, boy?" I said, "Well, I got something, man, but I ain't too sure about it, man. I think it might be a little too much. I don't know how folks are going to take it, but I think it's awesome, you know." He said, "Well, let me hear it." I said, "All right." I said, "Well, I'm poor boy proud and like to get around. Bye.
about working in the sun, picking guitar, grocery shopping with a gun. You just prove if you ain't drug no buck up in a four-wheel drive. And in true coon-ass fashion, he said, oh, that's a bad son of a bitch right there, boy. Fired up, and I was like, man, really? He's like, dude, that's the one right there, that's the one. So I took showman's advice of all people, but if you knew him, you probably know that shouldn't have been what I did. But I took showman's advice and played it a few days later in the change room for the rest of the guys, man, and they was like, man, that's awesome. So, you know, I wasn't sure about it. You know, Ashley wasn't sure about it. I remember when we sent it to the little mom and pop radio that we dealt with back at the time, I was so scared for my dad to hear that song, because it wasn't no moaning the blues and blue collar boys, and I didn't know how he was going to take it at all. I remember calling my brother, man, like, I got this song recorded, I'm going to send it to you. Uncle Hop and my brother, I used to send them music early, and they'd fight over who was going to get it first, you know, it was kind of a running joke, but I think Wade got blue collar first, and I called him a day or two later, and he called me. I said, man, you know, what you think about the song? Now, my brother, he's old school to his heart, too. He's 5 years older than me, but he acts like he's 65. No offense to anybody who's 65, but he's got an old soul. I don't know about that, brother. You wasn't too sure about it either, but thank God Showman was right and Daddy and my brother was wrong. Mike, anybody with a question, man, I'll take one, if anybody's got one.
All right, we got one right back here in the back. What's your name?
Mike from Kilgore, Texas.
Kilgore, Texas.
I wonder what I can do to get one of them signed black bull hides.
Get a signed black bull hide? I can get you hooked up. I only got this one with me, so you can't get this until Saturday. But I'll make you a promise. You find me Saturday after the show, this man gets this signed bullhead off the blue collar blue collar.
Any other questions? Question, there we go. I'm gonna go here and then there. What's your name? Where are you from? He said, oh shit.
Mike.
Where are you from, man?
Yuba City, California, baby.
Hey!
My man.
Yes, sir.
As an independent artist,
yes, sir.
And blazing your own trail, like you've done, you haven't sold out, haven't done any of that shit at all. When do you think you can start doing some West Coast stuff? You've been branching out a little bit. But now, I know that you have a booking agent. I know that, but you also got a little say kind of where you're going.
Yeah.
So what do you got? Maybe on the West Coast, there's thousands and thousands of people who love your music. And so we need some love over here for the guys who can't drive in from Arkansas, Alabama, Louisiana, wherever. So I flew my ass to Louisiana and got fucked up over there. And I got my ass fucked up, my drunk ass on that ship. And yeah, I've been fucked up ever since. So, West Coast, baby, we're getting to the West Coast.
I promise you that I'm coming to California. I promise you I'm coming to California. Listen, there's something in the works right now. I may get there in July. I'm not sure about it. And I shouldn't let this out into the world. It's 50-50 right now. But there's a chance that I probably shouldn't let that out right now. If it don't happen, I don't want you to be disappointed. But if we don't come to California next year, this year, I know we'll be there next year. But Northern California, yeah. Listen, I heard, Hank, I'm from North California, South Alabama. But there's a chance that there's a tour going on this summer. It starts in the spring, but it goes to the summer. And it's called Outlaws and Legends. And there's a chance that it will be me, Charlie Daniels, and Travis Tritt will be coming. A chance. So when y'all go to bed tonight, y'all say your prayers if that happens.
What's your name and where you from, my friend?
Gary Anderson, North Wilkesboro, North Carolina.
Oh, okay.
When you coming back to make some videos over there?
Yes, so what he's talking about, this man's from North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. That's where the Backwoods Baby Doll video was shot, in North Wilkesboro, North Carolina. My video guy, Brett Bortle, he's got the keys to the city over there. So anytime we do something crazy, need to have a shootout, we're coming to see y'all, all right? All right.
Hold on. Yeah, she's right here too. Where are you from?
I'm from Memphis, Tennessee.
All right.
What's your name?
Paige. I just wanted to know if you had like a moment where you were standing there and you were there and you were like, wow, I really made it. Like what that moment was for you.
You know what? Honestly, this was one of those moments, you know, just signing up for this and coming out here and the fact that, you know, we've had everyone talk. You're from Tennessee, from California, had some from Virginia. I've talked to people from Minnesota and New Jersey. And, you know, it's just unbelievable that, you know, that you guys would take the time out of your schedules, spend your money, plan your vacation around me. That blows my mind. So this is definitely one of those ones. You know, the stuff with Hank Jr., definitely, you know, some of those moments and you know, one of my proudest moments in country music in my career has been the Cypress Bottoms that we used to do. Those were incredible, you know, and whether we do another one ever or not, we don't know, but you can't take those memories away from me and everybody who attended those things. Was absolutely redneck Woodstock. It was awesome. It was a lot of fun. Anybody in here came to Cypress Bottom? Any of them? That's so awesome. So awesome. By the way, Richard Craighead, this guy right here. Stand up, Richard. I went to high school with this guy, Richard Craighead. While I was doing dumb stuff, like, you know, thought I was cool chasing cheerleaders around, this dude was making money. This guy, if you get to the dock and your car's broke down, find this guy, all right? He can fix anything. Richard, good to see you. It's his honeymoon. Y'all give him a hand. I seen his wife, too. He outkicked his coverage by about 35 yards. So y'all pray for him tonight, too. Man, what are we going to play now? Hot leaned on me real hard for about 6 years. I mean, you don't ever play this song no more. Why not? I don't know, man. Can't play them all. So he came to Nashville. Him and the Ledbetters, they came up this year. They came up and figured, you know what? Had just enough to drink. We'll get along this one tonight. And the crowd response was so good that night, me playing this song that I hadn't played in forever, that there hadn't been a show since then that I ain't played it. So, how about one off the old Rowdy Reputation album, I think. Is that the one that was on? Or the second one, Red Wings? What was my biggest fans on, Red Wings and Six Strings? Is that what it was on? Y'all should know. Anyway. Got a big cramp down on Broadway. Getting loud tonight. And here I stand up in the spotlight. Play a few of my old songs, play a couple of sing-alongs, make sure it's Sunday night. And whether they remember me tomorrow is really out of my hands, but with the help of old Jim Beam, not there, my biggest fans. They're gonna roll the right away, so they don't care if I get them wrong. They just wanna hear drinking, a cheating, a loving, and a good leaving song. Y'all know I'm no big star, 'cause tonight
biggest fan. Hear me, you know, Jim Beam, knocking them dead down here on this big old boat tonight again. Tofa Peterson, where you at? Come on, sing. You know what he just did? Damn. Come on now. What up with her? Anybody hang out with Topher last night? Bless your heart. Ashley mixed some Pedialyte up in the room and said, bring this to Topher. I said, no. He deserves everything you get. No, I love Topher, man. I'm gonna tell you something about Topher. The old wanna punch him in the face guy. So when I moved to Nashville, green as grass, didn't know a thing. Moved there, didn't know anybody. For some reason, Ashley thought it was a good idea too. Yeah, baby, let's go. You know, so we went. So went to Nashville, didn't know a soul. Sat there for a year, didn't know what to do. Finally, Miss Ashley said, you know, being in Nashville all is cool, but you gonna do anything? You just gonna come home from a gig and ride your four wheel around on the farm all day? So, that was the G version. So anyway, I started going to songwriters nights because somebody told me that was the thing to do. I didn't know. So started going to this place called the Fiddlin' Steel. It's not even there anymore. It's on Printer's Alley in Nashville, Tennessee. It's where I first cut my teeth doing this stuff, man. Went up there, there was always a songwriter, and I think it was on Wednesday, which would just flat guarantee wouldn't be a soul in there, which was perfect for me, because I didn't know what I was doing. Still don't. But anyway, one night I'm in there, and the way it worked is you got your turn. You know, there'd be four or five songwriters. There was always more songwriters there to play than there was people there to see. So there'd be 10 songwriters and 6 people sitting in the front row, and that'd be it, the place would be empty. So I'm up there one night, I get my shot. As soon as I get up to the stage, I start playing in Whiskey on the House. I had wrote it, but it wasn't out on anything. And these two cats walk in, he's one of them. Tofa Peterson, old Tommy Howard. Let me tell y'all something about Tommy Howard. Don't film this, but he's high as hell somewhere right now. He didn't make it. He's one of the tragic stories. You know, he stayed in Nashville until he ran out of money and had to go back to the house. It happens a lot, but old Tommy didn't make it. But Topher walks in, and he was in the kind of shape he was in last night. So he walks in and sits down over here at the table, and I swear, y'all, it was me, the sound guy, who was drunker than anybody else in there, didn't know what he was doing. There was 2 people sitting over here. My poor wife actually was sitting there guarding her purse with her life, about 2 tables out. And Topher and Tommy sat down over here to the left. So I'm doing my thing. Look at these cats. So I start playing Whiskey on the House. Lord knows I ain't cut out to be no politician, man. Dun, dun, dun. Hell yeah! I'm on president, damn sure makes it. Woo! That's what I'm talking about. So this goes on through every line of the whole song, right? Yeah, he still likes it. Don't know the name of it, but he likes it. So I don't know, you know, me being nervous and just being intimidated by the whole Nashville scene anyway, I don't know who he is from anybody. I can't make up my mind whether he's picking on me, you know, whether he's ribbing me pretty good, or if he really likes it, because he's in the shape he was in last night, you just can't tell. So I have made up my mind, and I'm not a fighter, never been in one, don't want to get in one, you know. So, but I had made up my mind. I said, my wife is sitting right there. I said, I'm either gonna get off his stage and hit this guy right between the eyes, or shake his hand and be his best friend. I hope it turns out to be the latter, but I don't know, but I had made up my mind that's what I was gonna do. So I get done, boom, here Here I go. He jumps up, he said, man, that was pretty good stuff right there. And I said, I appreciate it. Who are you? Topher Peters. So that's how I met Topher. He's the first musician I met in Nashville, Tennessee.
Does he remember it?
Yeah, he remembers it. Unless he's in the shape he was in last night. Which happens sometimes. But anyway, Topher proved to me one thing, because I've never really been anywhere. But Topher proved to me you don't have to be from the same spot to like the same stuff and be like-minded folks. Me and Topher started hanging out, and we started playing music together and listening to music together. And I didn't run into a lot of people who knew as much Bo Sivas as I did, but this cat right here, y'all, he knows. So, Topher's the kind of guy who tells us stories. He's from Indiana, so y'all give it up for Indiana. I'll tell you who Topher was as a teenager. He's the guy, and he's telling on himself, but Topher was the guy from north of the Mason-Dixon line would show up at a Hank Jr. concert with a rebel flag tied around his neck, no shirt. Woo! That's this guy. So y'all give it up for Topher Peterson. That I fell in love with as a child, because it was the true sense of artistry for y'all, for those of you who don't know, which everybody in here knows because y'all follow good stuff. But Hank Jr. fell off a mountain in 1974 or 5. And then I knew all those stories, and then I heard the song digging around in Uncle Hop's cassettes somewhere, probably, stealing them, along with a pack of smokes every now and then, you know, back across the road. But anyway, I heard this song and I was like, man, that is the coolest thing. This dude falls off a mountain, lived over it, wrote a song about it, and that's what made me fall in love with that type of music, is songs like this one here. I will screw this up, he'll screw this up. Any of y'all ever heard of All in Alabama by Hank Jr.? Yeah. Let's do it. Put your hands in, come on, help me. I just ain't sure that didn't need. So I wish to see some old friends of mine. Thought if I climbed over old Ajax Mountain, maybe that would help me get out of my mind. I made it up to the top, I picked out a clear spot. I thought a whole lot about the rest of my life. I had no idea then soon it was nearly end. Up on this mountainside, I would nearly die. Stand up and sing it with me if you know it. In your didn't die, not in Montana, no, Lord. You let me get back to my old homeland. And I'm gonna hold on to a hand. Give it up. Last verse. They said I've never sang again. I learned a lot about old friends. When you're shot down and out, oh, you don't get many calls. Then I saw some tears and some eyes, and soon my poor old mother died. I nearly lost it all when I lost my grandpa. And you can find us all. Yeah, we're all down in deep.
She said.
Okay.
What's your question?
Well, my husband is here with his twin brother, and I know that there's a special bond between brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Their favorite song of yours is Pete and John.
Oh.
We've been to several concerts, and we're out there hollering for it. Pete and John, Pete and John.
How about let's do it?
Let's do it.
About these cats while we on that subject. They are brothers. That's my dad and his the next brother in line. Hop's the baby of 11, correct? I can't even remember them all. But Hop's my dad's brother, but Pete and John was the there was two girls and then there was the first two boys spit out. And y'all, when I tell you Wildcats, all right? They don't make them like that no more. We've all got those folks in our lives, our dads and grandpas and uncles who are just a dying breed from a different time, you know, that are sometimes passing on without their due, in my opinion. And I didn't want that to happen with Pete and John. And so I wrote a song for them, and I'll try to get through this one too. How's it start? One hit the ground in 50. Y'all better speak up. Are y'all supposed to know this?
I tried to pay.
Huh?
You want me to turn the phone on?
One hit the ground in 50. 51. Back to back, granddaddy, Mac and Juanita had some sons. Dirt floor poor, barefoot boys, toy pistols on their side. Learning to run, having fun, old Pete and John. Hitting up on the branch, 111 was 12. A single barrel shotgun and a few old faded shells. One old buck, well, he was dumb enough to stop in front of that gun. having fun on old Pete and John. Well, here come the 60s, and here come the cars, and here come two wild young cowboys running all the bars, drinking sand, chasing wild women into the morning sun. Getting them done, having fun on the old Pete and John. Never been two brothers, two others, even more one and same. Yeah, they served this country proud and punched holes in the ground. They could do most anything. They were just a product of lessons learned about life and love in a place where the good Lord sets a son. They were loved by Him, loved by everyone. Oh, Pete and John. South of the Arkansas line, telling campfire stories to the ones they'll leave behind, about all the ups and downs and rounds of a pretty damn good run. Anything they'd done, they was world champion. Oh, Pete and John.
Thank you for asking for that, and thank you for appreciating that. I appreciate y'all. Thank you. You know, all the songs that we have that commercially are successful, it's the ones like that that mean the absolute world to me. And I know that you guys, the true blue, not just the fly-by-night fans, the true blue fans who buy the albums and play them 1 through 10 all the time, don't skip a song. I know you guys appreciate those songs, and I appreciate that. Thank you. So the running joke for me is, if you think Pete and John's good, wait till Hot Dan and Fred comes out. That's right. That's the rest of the boys. I got you covered, okay? I got you covered. You got a question, Mike?
Yeah.
Yes, I do.
What's your name?
Does anybody have water or a beer or something?
We don't have water, we just have beer. What was the origin of Miss Janie? We have a argument right here. I'm sorry. You can tell me later.
All right. Hold on. Let him get that.
They don't want me to drink on the stage because of the electronics, which I totally understand, so I'm having to walk around. But so the origin of Miss Jane. Well, I was just like any other teenager, did a little experiment in my time. So you know what? That's the same thing my dad asked me. Boy, what the hell are you talking about? Well, anyway, yeah, Miss Janie is what you think it is, Mary Jane. Not a habit that I've toted through my life at all. But you know, as teenagers, young boys and girls, I experiment a little bit, and yeah. So that's what it's about. It made a good song, and that's a beautiful thing about songwriting, is you can say something like that. And there's been people walk up to me and
and like, tell me about that Miss Janie lady and what really happened. You know? Is she like way older? I'm like, well, yeah, man, she's like 40 and I was 15. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, the origin of Miss Janie is what you think it is. And, you know, from time to time, we still have a good time, but not, no. I'm a grown up, you know what I mean? Ain't got nothing against it, but, you know. Go ahead, Mike.
What's your name?
Caleb.
Y'all give it up for Caleb Brooks.
Dolan, Louisiana.
Yes. Listen, this guy right here. if it was 8 o'clock at night, I'd make you take your shirt off. But I ain't going to do that to you. Caleb Brooks, man, give it up for him. One of the biggest Frank Foster fans of ever been. Yeah. So, Caleb, I love you, man. Just know that.
Appreciate it, man. I want to take you off of all the music questions for just a minute.
Yeah. Did you do research?
No. Yeah. I've asked you this before, but you won't answer me.
Okay.
I want to know who it is you pay to push all them turkeys out the bushes right as you can. And I want to hear about the turkeys that you, I'm telling y'all, this guy orders turkeys in a box. I know he does this. He cuts the box open, kicks it over, and walks off. I know he does. I just want to know the website you order
from. Yeah, okay. Well, you know, turkeysforrookies.com is where I order them. Now listen, y'all, when Ashley and I moved to Tennessee, I was blown away. Is anybody here from Middle Tennessee or anywhere? Yeah, these good folks right here. So y'all know how it is. Turkeys everywhere. I'd never seen nothing like it. And where we live at, where I live, you know, I got property and it's about 70%, it's about 70-30 field to woods. They can't hide, man. They can't hide. So they fly down out of the trees, they in the wide open. Man, look at this. So, yeah, I don't have turkeys on speed dial, but I will tell you a funny story. My brother is, and these guys can vouch for this, one of the best woodsmen you're ever gonna meet. You can put him in the woods, 2 shells, and he can survive for 2 weeks. He's that type of cat. If he goes, he's coming back with something. That's the way he's always been. And he's got 3 boys, and he's raised them that way. And the middle one, Will, he's kind of like me. He's a little mouth, you know, a little mouth, you know what I'm saying? Likes to talk a little junk, and he's pretty good at it. So he's become a great hunter himself. So I moved up to Tennessee, and a couple of turkey seasons went by, and I was getting a limit. You can get 4 in Tennessee. Bam, 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 getting a limit 2 or 3 years in a row. Well, he called me one day, my brother. He said, man, I think we're going to come turkey hunting up there. Will and Jake, they've been pushing hard. They want to come up there. It's like, man, hell yeah, man. Gate's open. Come on. He's like, tell you something funny. I was like, what? He said, oh, Will, which Will was about 13 at this time and killing turkeys just like a grown man. He said, I'll tell you why Will wants to come up there so bad. He thinks he can get the limit in 2 or 3 days. I was like, why does he think that? He said, he came here the other night and said, Daddy, I want to go up to Uncle Frank's and go hunting. So bad. He's like, if he's getting a limit every year, it's gotta be easy. Come on, Will. So yeah, so that's the way the turkey hunt goes in Tennessee. I will tell you this, it's a tad bit easier than it is in Louisiana. It's just like deer hunting. The rut comes. And those of you from the Midwest who deer hunt, anybody from the Midwest? They get to chasing one, they just run out in the field. Look, I can hit one now. If he'll stop, I can hit it. That's the way my hunting goes. Give me another question, Mike.
All right, before that, tell y'all a real funny story. When me and Frank started talking about doing this cruise together, I said, how about April? No, that's turkey season. No, we ain't doing it then. Take another day.
Yeah, so I'm going out there.
Go ahead.
I'm Maria from Jackson, Mississippi area.
Oh, I like it.
Big fan. Thanks. I was supposed to be coming on this cruise with one of my friends, and she backed out at the last minute, so I wasn't going to miss you, and I'm here.
Awesome.
But I met these lovely ladies from Louisiana who've just taken me in. This one right here loves Bayou Moon. Will you please play that for her?
Oh my gosh.
Please.
Let me tell you something about Bayou Moon.
We will try to be prepared on Saturday, okay? That's way too far back in the catalog and way too complicated for me to do on a whim like that. So I'm sorry about that. Boys, you got some homework before Saturday. So, speaking of, what time is it, Jace? What time we got? Just in my ear, you good? Okay, good. Y'all wanna bring the guys out and do a few? That guy's got a question, Mike. Go holler at him.
All right. Excuse me, pardon me, pardon me, excuse me. Pardon me, excuse me. I want to put my butt in your face. Go ahead.
Hey, Frank, it's an honor to be here. My wife and I met you last night on our 25th wedding anniversary. Best decision we made in a long time.
Awesome. Coming around this. Tell them where you're from,
bro. We're actually from Bloomington, Indiana, Hoosier, like Topher. And I will say this. I also wave a rebel flag, and we just look like we're just taking back some Yankee territory. But I wanted to talk to you briefly last night. You know, I've been in the Coast Guard going 21 years now, serving in Louisiana and Texas.
Thank you for your service.
If you would, do one for the soldiers and sailors here on the boat, and just want to thank you, and I'm glad I drugged my wife here 25 years to this, because it's freaking awesome.
Dude, absolutely. Brother, thank you for your service. That's absolutely incredible. I don't have a song that is specifically tailored to the soldiers, but we did one the other night, and we're going to do it again Saturday. And Saturday, before we do it, we're going to get you to stand up, and we're going to thank you and every other veteran in here when we do it. And the reason is the last verse. You may not lay down your life for the land of the free, for the stars and the stripes, but some of us still do it. We'll do that for you. So, we gave the boys an extra hour to sober up. Y'all give them a hand for stumbling to the stage. And speaking of veterans, y'all, my bus driver, Mr. Roy Wellman, Army vet, right back there, give it up for him. I worry about a lot of things in life, but when I step aboard the bus with Roy, I have no more worries. This guy's been an absolute champion. Roy, thank you for everything that you do. I'll have to get something done before we start. By the way, this is Mr. Andrew Timothy right here. He's from Mobile, Alabama. And here's the bandit, Mr. Clint Reynolds from Mississippi. J-Dub, Mr. Jeremy Warren from right down there in Louisiana, where I come from. And of course, Topher from good old Indiana, man. Topher grew up where Michael Jackson grew up. That's what's wrong with him. Awesome to meet all y'all. But this lady told me I had an accent. I said, no, you got an accent. Where's New Jersey at?
New Jersey.
Just tell us anything. Like, y'all listen to this one. Watch this.
I actually raised my hand and my husband told me to put it down.
Oh, well then ask me a question.
I don't have a question. I just want to thank you. This is my first contract, and my husband's a fan. I wasn't, but I am now.
Thank you for dragging that, my man.
I still don't think I have an accent.
You got an accent, sweetheart. You got one. So we're going to play a few more for you guys, man. Like I said, y'all welcome the boys to the stage. We can't go forward. I can ask that. It's comfortable in here, right? We're playing a turkey song. What else are we going to be playing? It's all this turkey. Y'all had enough to drink to clap in rhythm or not?
Good coffee, home brew.
start to a good day. I grab my boots and my pocket change. Get out the door and down to the store and have a biscuit with the same old man. Yeah, I let the simple things get me by. Won't let nobody blow my high. I let the big boat ride. Lock the Door, when it goes to the bridge, it's only got one line in the song, right, that you hear. It actually was supposed to have two. But the guy that was helping me record the album, when I was offshore, cut it out, and when I got home, that's the way it was. And it's just bothered me ever since. So I know that y'all love it and I appreciate it, but it's always missing something for me. So that's why I never play it. But Saturday, I'll give you a piece of Lock the Door, I promise. So this song right here, little behind the song on this one, man, I wrote this song a long time ago, and I always loved it, just waiting on the right record to put it on. And we put it on the Till I'm Gone album. This song is really special to me. A lot of fun. We probably screw it up, but how about a little Homebody Rambling?
Oh, Like I'm on the phone, never come around.
since I'm no way. Since the last time we saw you smiling, we rode that bridge to the promised land. I hope y'all enjoyed today, man.
You don't get to see that very often, you know what I'm saying? It's right there. But he wanted to make sure, Frank and the guys wanted to make sure that you could ask questions and he'd give you the answers and tell some stories. So we appreciate y'all listening and enjoying it. Thank y'all again for coming, and we'll do our last show on Saturday, y'all. Okay? Thank you.